All right then, I have promised you to also write a object guard, or better to say guarded object, and that's what we're gonna do in this video. I already wrote something like that, but yeah, we're gonna see how I'm gonna attempt to write this now. Let's see. So let's get started. Alright then, first of all, we're gonna create a new file here, a header file, and this header file will be called guarded object. And there we go. Now let's grab our default includes from maybe the lockguard, because this also includes everything that we need. Lockguard, guarded object, there it is. And let's start writing the actual class. So of course it's gonna be a class, it's gonna be a lock guard, so an object that guards a object, basically. And of course we need some template parameters, because templates are king. So first of all, we need a type name T, which is the object to be guarded. And then we're gonna need another type name, there we go. And this is the LT, basically this is the type of the lock, the so-called lock type. And to assert that this is really a lock, I'm gonna add some type traits. Type name equals, we don't need a name for type traits, so basically this adds another type which is invalidating the full class instance in case one, the kind of like in case the expression below there invalidates to false. But then we'll see this after I'm gonna include this. So let's include type traits, type traits, there we go. And we're gonna use the std enable if t. It's a templated, let's call it function basically, or not function. This is basically returning a type, and it's returning an error type that results the class to not construct in case the expression we have in there is false. So in case I just type false, this class would never be constructible. In case I type true, this case is now constructible. But of course we will not type in false or true. We will type some other parameters that are dependent on the template arguments. So what I'm writing here is std is base of v, which is basically a value. And when you take out the arguments, you have a base and a derivate. The base will be our iLock, so basically our lock interface, and the derivate is the LT, so the type of lock. And basically, this expression will, like this expression here, will evaluate to true if the given type LT in this space here, if this LT is of base iLock. So in case this type name that we are inputting here is a lock, then the function, the class will construct. In case it's not an iLock, it will not construct. So this is very simple type traits here, and this is very nice because we can easily just disallow the construction of like a class. All right, now we need some arguments. First of all, we need the lock itself. So and lock type myLock. Maybe we should also like do LT to call the default constructor there to be 100% sure. So basically, this is the guarding lock. Guarding lock. It's not lock guard. I'm stupid. Guarded object. There we go. Guarded object. And of course, we need the object itself. So we're gonna have a T, my object. And this is gonna be. Yeah, it's interesting because we can construct this in several ways. Alright, speaking of constructors, I want to have a default constructor. Just take this like that. So we have a default constructor. Default construct. We will not be able to copy from that. This will be deleted. But I want to be actually able to copy from the other object. So a tref here, which basically is copying from another instance of t. So basically what I'm saying is my object is equal to tref. So an automatic struct, maybe let's construct, let's call it like that. So basically just creating this from a reference there. I mean, we could also like do a move operation here. So t move here as well. So we can say my object is cd move t move here to make us a move constructor available from the other one, And this should be good. Yeah, so I think this is quite good, but it's not sufficient. I also want to be able to basically call this default construct and special construct, because I also want to be able to create this guarded object as it would be a T. And it's actually not that hard to do. We need some more template magic for that. So I'm going to take another type name. In this case, a variadic type name, arguments or argument types, ATS in my case. And we have a guarded object and we have ATS args. So we have some arguments here. And what I'm going to do here is basically, let's maybe do this like that. I'm basically calling my lock and I'm calling, not my lock, my object, and I'm basically calling now the T constructor with args. Actually, or is it like that? I think it's like that. I'm not quite sure with that variadic stuff because it's like a bit annoying. I don't know if it's in that direction or that, but we're gonna see if this should go like that. But basically, this should allow you to basically also call to create a guarded object as if you would construct T. And we're gonna hope that this will work. We're gonna see this in a second. Actually, we could already try this out. Oh, let's guarded object. There we go. I don't need the lock guard anymore now. Let's remove that and let's also get rid of that. So let's maybe create a simple class here. Let's call this class just C. And let's just make some constructor here. So we're gonna have a C with an and X and Y, which is basically doing nothing. Yeah, I think this should be good. Yeah, probably. Let's see if we can create C here, CD, CX. No default constructor exists. Yeah, let's set a default here as well. There we go. So we now can easily instantiate C, and now we should also be able to create a core concurrent guarded object of type C. And now we need a lock, of course. So of course we need the spin lock as well. Let's spin lock here, and we can also now create a core concurrent spin lock to guard this with a spin lock, and let's call it just obj. Maybe let's add an argument here. So basically this is the int arg. And what I'm saying here is arg equal to x plus y maybe. Let's do this like that. And then the default constructor, I'm saying, or maybe let's do this like that. So I'm saying this args is 0 by default. Or maybe let's make it 5 to distinguish from uninitialized memory. So now with the default, let's see what it's going to do. So if we take a look at the object now, we have this internal object with argument 5. So you can see like that the proper default constructor was called. Now let's try out to create a CX here, and let's maybe say CX 5, 5, which basically should be 10. And let's now create this by X here, so without move. And let's see if we get an object with 10 in there. Yeah, and we have an object with 10. This is working. Let's make this public here as well so that we can access it. And now let's try the fancy shit out. We see that we could just do this like that. We saw that we get like the value of 5. And now we're gonna try out if we're gonna be able to call the arguments by just calling 5 and 5 here. Let's see if we're gonna deduce or if we're gonna get an issue. Now we don't get an issue, and you can see that the object has the proper value of 10. So you can see like the proper constructor is called. In case I add more arguments, we will get an issue, not a compile time and not a IntelliSense issue, but like a Visual Studio issue, and then cannot convert from an initializer list to T. Because it's not properly creating that one. Yeah, maybe we should also add a default argument. It's better to have it. Maybe do this like that. But this could actually arise an issue in case we don't have a default argument. Yeah, we're gonna see. Not a default constructor, but we're gonna see. Maybe this is also not like... Yeah, I don't want to have this like that. I mean, it's a bit bad that it gives us a warning, but yeah. So you can like see this is not working because it's not matching any constructor of Z, but in case I would alter the constructor here and say we're gonna add an index Z here and we're gonna add Z as well, then you will see that this compiles again and properly calls the constructor. We should get 15 in there. Yeah, there we go. Edit. So again, this is exactly what I want. So you can see like the constructor is properly working. Let's actually keep this testing here and continue writing on the guarded object. We don't need a destructor because they both clean up itself. We just need some member access function. So yeah, we do not want to publicly expose our guarded object here. And to accomplish that, we need some more classes. We need a guarded object proxy. This is a proxy. What the heck am I doing? So, right, remove that. So, basically, a proxy. This is a proxy object to access T. Of course, if you want to access T, we also need T. In this game, we just need T here because you're going to see what I'm going to do here. And that's basically the core guarded object. All right, so a proxy can be on different modes. It can be read-only, or maybe do we want to actually write two proxies? I'm not quite sure. Let's just write a write-only proxy for now. And yeah, let's just do this. So basically what this proxy is going to have, it's going to have a pointer to object. Null pointer, and it's going to have an iLog pointer. Pointer lock. Actually, no, it's not going to have a pointer to lock. Actually, it's going to have a lock guard because we already implemented that. So we can also make use of that. So let's just quickly include modern GX here, core concurrent lock guard. And basically, it's basically the pointer to proxy object. And we gonna have a lock guard. M lock guard. So, not like that, sorry. Lock guard. And this is basically the guard that locks the object. And actually, I don't think that we really want that. Or actually, yes, we can do this. It works with that. All right, so we're gonna have a default constructor, which of course works. So some constructs here. We will not have a copy constructor, but we may gonna have a move constructor. This is gonna be available. And what this move constructor basically says, it's gonna take the, it's basically the moving the lock guard. So my lock guard is std move other lock guard, and we're gonna take the pointer of there. It's gonna be a big, so let's make this like that and say move construct. Basically what we're saying is we're gonna copy the pointer from the other one, and we are actually clearing the other's pointer to a null pointer. And what std move here is basically doing is it should prevent the destructor of the other guarded object proxy, prevent the constructor from being called, at least on the not with the proxy, or at least on the lock guard. This is the idea. Yeah, so basically this is just moving all data out there. And we're gonna have another construct with a t pointer, pointer object, and an iLock pointer, pointer lock. There we go. And basically what we are gonna do here is we're gonna create our lock guard from our lock pointer. You know that from the last video. And our object pointer from the object here. And well, this is basically how the constructor works. This will basically call acquire. Parameterized construct. So basically, as you can see, this will automatically create, in case you call the write constructor, it will create a janitor object at the lock, which is acquiring the lock. And it's going to copy the pointer to that object, basically exposing that object to that class. Now we're actually able to write some functions here. So we're going to have the pointer function, so pointer access. So basically, we're going to have a get function. So we're gonna have a T reference, and we have the function get here. Actually not non-accept, because this could be an issue, and also not cons. We can throw issues, we can't throw exceptions, so I'm gonna check if not my pointer object, I'm gonna throw an exception. Do I have a base exception, or did I made this with an std exception? I think I made it with std exceptions. Let's take a look at the win main. I'm doing this with standard object exceptions. So we're gonna throw an std exception. It doesn't have exception available, so let's include this exception here. So we're gonna throw an std exception and just gonna say, so we're gonna check object pointer. Actually, I'm just gonna do this on debug because I don't want to sacrifice speed on this checkings. Exceptions is just for debugging purpose here. So I'm gonna write get function called on invalid object guard, just like that. And then I'm gonna just return the ref, and it's just returning difference referenced my pointer object. All right, get reference to T, and then we're also gonna have a pointer, so get pointer to T, and this is gonna be non-accept. So we have a T pointer here, pointer function here, and this is non-accept because a pointer is a bit more nicer, so we can just return the pointer to the object here without an issue. And we're also gonna have some more functions. First of all, I wanna have an operator T pointer. Operator T pointer, so an automatic conversion here, non-accept. So auto convert to T pointer. Just returning the pointer to an object. There we go. And what I also want to do is I want to maybe support or not support special operators. So we're going to delete the assign operator. So operator equal const other is going to be deleted. But we may want to support move assign. So move from another object. This may be possible, but this should do non-accept, but this is alright. I don't know, did we implement it in the lockguard in SCD move? Actually not. So we're not gonna support this one here as well, so just remove that. Not gonna support the sign, which basically also renders that as useless, but yeah. It should be good. I mean, if we need it, we can implement this later on. All right, then let's now go back to that one, because that one also needs to implement some more operators. So delete the assign operator. So operator, there we go. This one is not going to be supported, and the operator for moving, this is be supported here, because it's a bit more easy, because we can just say my log equals to std move other my log, and I hope this is going to work at least. And we're going to try this out, maybe it throws an error, but yeah. So we're just gonna copy, and then here we're just gonna say my object equals std move other object. Actually, this is like the default one, the default move. We could try this out if default is working here. Maybe it's not, but yeah, let's just write it out. I mean, it's not a title to rewrite this. All right, so support move. And yeah, now we wanna, I don't know if actually the move is actually returning a reference, but I think yes. Now we actually wanna support a function that can gain access to that. We're gonna have multiple functions here. So we're gonna support, we always support constant reading. So this is going to be a proxy that always supports reading. So get read own only ref. Basically, it returns a const t reference. Basically, just going to call this function here read, which is non-accept, or which actually const non-accept. And this will just return a reference to my object. Very simple. Get read only pointer here as well. We're going to have a const t pointer, read pointer. Read pointer, const non-accept. We're just returning a pointer to my object here. And we will also have an operator. So we're going to have an operator const t pointer. Const const no accept here. Just going to just return also a pointer to my object here as well. So conversion to pointer. To const pointer. So that we can like always read from that object. I mean, we cannot like actually we cannot assert unique read, which may be something you want. You may want to have multiple proxies. It could be that you don't want to have access to that anyways. You want to always like wait until the other one is finished reading. But basically, at least for my cases where I use that stuff, you may also like want to peek from a different thread to just get a value. To just kind of like read a state, in which state this object is currently. So most of the time it's important. Yes, I mean, we could actually like, to make this a bit more safer, explicit this operator, which means that you need to manually type const t reference to manually cast this to get this. But at least like these can be very easily. And okay. Now the interesting function you all have waited for, to retrieve a proxy, so the guarded object proxy. So we, to get a guarded object proxy of type T, we're gonna call a function called, how are we gonna call this? I'm not gonna call this write, I'm gonna call this get RV proxy, because we basically can read and write on that, and it's no longer const, but it is no accept. So get read write access to object. And what this is basically doing, it's going to return a guarded object proxy of type T. And arguments for that proxy is, if we can scroll up here, is pointer object and pointer lock. Actually, like, this is a bit, move constructor is a bit like, you don't need this really. You may need this, but actually the move assign would be a bit better. I may try to implement the move assign anyways at some point. But yeah, you need first of all a pointer to the object and then a pointer to the lock. So basically what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna input a pointer to an object and I'm gonna input a pointer to my lock. Just as simple as this. And this should make the guarded object finished. I mean, it's like very lightweight and easy to understand a C++ templated madness class. But it should do its job. Let's see if I made any mistake there. Alright. Now let's try this out. Maybe let's get an auto reference cref, and I'm calling a object read. Let's see what we're gonna get here. Is it compiling? Yeah, it's compiling, and we also have the cref, which is also pointing to our object. So this is a const c reference. So if we would like try to write to this. This would fail and not compile because we just have a read-only access. If you want to have a reference, a actual like good access to that object, we would need to first create a proxy. But this actually works a bit different. So basically, what we would do, we're gonna do auto rv for read and write, and I would call object get read write proxy, and then I can do rv. Actually, I forgot something. I wanted to also write the pointer operator at the proxy itself. Here are we. So the pointer access operator. So operator ft operator operator pointer no accept is gonna return a my pointer object. And I also want to have the pointer operator down here, actually. Where do we have it here? Maybe actually, let's move this one down because this doesn't should be there. And let's make the operator down here. So we're gonna have an operator const t pointer operator here const no accept return pointer to object so that we can like access this with the pointer operator. And basically what you can do now in the winmain is you can just treat this rv as a pointer, and I can just say arg is like, now it's 15, let's make it 10 now. And yeah, this is how this works. Maybe let me also do some more on the proxy here. I maybe want to manually close the proxy. So close proxy manually. So we're gonna write a void close here. No accept, which is basically closing the proxy. So I'm saying if my wrong class up here. Right close, so if my pointer object, then I'm gonna of course clear the pointer to the object, and I also need to close the generator. Did I implement that? No, I haven't implemented this at the generator and the generator. Where is my lock guard? There's my lock guard, but I don't have the header open. Why is my Visual Studio so garbage? Because I'm debugging currently. Guarded object, lock guard. So let's go back to the lock guard and let's add a manual close function here. So void close const. No, not const, just non-accept. And this is like a proper C++ class, which is not templated. So we're gonna do this in a CPP file. And basically what I'm gonna do in this close, I'm gonna check if my pointer is in existence. In the case it is in existence, I'm gonna say release and clear this to null pointer. Just like that. Very, very, very darn simple. And now I can use this here. So I can say my locker is gonna be closed here as I close my object. And everything is all right. I could also like do this if the lock guard is in existence. So if the lock guard is valid, this looks a bit cleaner. And then I just close the proxy normal manually, so that I can like call rv close here. And yeah, let's try this out. If this is working, and it's not working, it's missing a. Oh, of course, I've mistyped the operator here. This shouldn't be there. Still not compiling. Lockguard does not support that. Is the lockguard not having a Boolean conversion? No, the lockguard is missing its Boolean conversion. That's not good. So operator bool is missing here on the lockguard, which is basically check if. Guard is valid, so basically this should call the isValid function, or we're just gonna copy paste this here, because like always calling functions is a bit, yeah, bit an idiot. But yeah, I mean the compiler would optimize this on release at least. But yeah, actually, are these functions in existence here for the proxy? Did I wrote them for them? No, I didn't wrote them. So let's easily write them for them as well. Operator bool. Boolean conversion, const no accept, return my pointer object, this is not null pointer, there we go, boolean check. Now this should compile, at least a helper, so yeah, looks good. And now our object should have an argument of 10. Yeah, it has now an argument of 10, we have properly set this. If we would try to move this down here, we would get an issue. We would get like, because this pointer is now a null pointer. Yeah, my pointer object was null pointer, which is exactly what we expect because we have closed the proxy. Now let's try to open up another proxy. So auto rv2 is equal to object get read write proxy. Let's try this out. What is it doing now? And as you can see, well, nothing is happening. We are in an infinite loop. And if we pause, you see that we are in a try-acquire function of a spinlock, which is being called by the acquire function of the iLock, which is being called by the acquire function of the lockGuard, which is being called by the constructor of that guarded object proxy, which is being called by the function getReadWrite proxy of the guarded object, which is being called by the getRVProxy instance in our winmain. And let's fake now that the lock was actually released, which is gonna break stuff. But yeah, we can just manually do this. So let's go into our guarded object obj. Let's go into the lock. Let's go into the lock flag. Sorry. Let's just dive down again until we get to the storage. Let's now modify this to 0 and let's continue on. And well, now we are working back again, and the infinite loop has terminated because I manually forced this lock to be released. But yeah, but the idea is basically that just one thread has this read-write proxy available. I mean, you can actually fool this system. It's not like 100% idiot safe. I could like say auto pointer PTR equals to RV pointer. And then I could now say pointer arc is 10. Which is still working, but now it's no longer concurrent. But it's like something, yeah, like you can see it's probably working. It's like if I took a look at the object, it's now 10. But it's definitely not what we want. And this is like conventions that you need to follow in case you have this read-write proxy. You should just always like see that it is working. I mean, we can easily work with that. I mean, you can like see if you just want to work with the object, we can say like object argument to read this, just like if we would access a pointer. Or we could like say read pointer argument in case we are having a pointer to a guarded object, for example. So we can just like always use this object pointer to just do stuff on that. In the case we want to actually like write modify this, we can like do auto p object get read write proxy, and then we can just say p arguments to modify this. So we kind of like have some nice operator stuff happening here in C++ to do stuff with that. And this should conclude the video to the guarded object itself. I hope it was useful, and yeah, make sure to like and subscribe, and have a nice day. Bye.